This morning?
Amen.
Summer is going quickly. I don't know why, but in my mind, I'm behind. I was thinking I had about 2 weeks left before the summer series. My wife, around Friday, said, you know, let me know when you want me to, because she's my editor. She said, let me know when you want me to start editing, you know, your lesson. I'm like, you got 2 weeks. Let that count, and we're done. So I told my daughter, I guess I better get busy. But, you know, they're both there, they're all done. Already, I'm raring to go, and I think that's quite good. You might say different, but I'm ready to go with that. Let us all stand today. As we stand today, I want to offer up a special prayer for Brother John. Some slight things going on with the heart, if I'm not mistaken. And so they're looking to release him, but let's continue to pray for him. I think he's sitting here feeling well, not getting fatigued or nothing like that. And went for our correctly a routine checkup, and his heart rate was very, very low. So let us pray for him that he'll be back with us soon and all things will work out well. Amen?
Amen.
And the prayers of the righteous may accomplish much. Let's continue to pray for Sister Juanita. I think she's out of town today, and others who are sick and afflicted. I have a friend in Akron, Brother Keith Kirk, and almost every time we talk, our departing words are always
much prayer.
And so this is really what God has asked of us, and so we pray. Be mindful of, and I keep saying this, and I think we minimize it, our responsibility as those who know the Lord, those who know Christ as Savior, is to faithfully give the gospel message. I think sometimes we think that it is an ineffective message. It's really not. The effectiveness of the message, it depends wholly upon the Holy Spirit convicting of sin and revealing to a person their need for Christ. We don't have to soup it up. We don't have to fix it up. We don't have to water it up. We don't have to sugar it up. There are just opportunities that God often presents before us just to give them one. The simple words of the gospel. I was getting my truck prepared not too long ago. I'm sitting in the place where you wait for your repairs, and a guy just starts talking to me and he's trying to explain Bible verses to me, and I'm just listening to it. And, you know, he's going on and on, and so, and he said, by the way, what do you do? So I began to share with him, and his eyes got that real big. And so I said, I take it, he was Jewish, I take it, you don't even read your own scriptures. And then I got an opportunity to take him to the Old Testament to show him that, you know, your promised Messiah, he's already come. Yeah. And his name is Jesus. So just always be ready to give an answer to anyone who asks of you the hope that you have in you. And that's why we are a teaching church. We want you to learn so the Holy Spirit can bring these things to your remembrance and use them when the opportunity arises. Amen?
Yeah.
Amen. Let's go to our opening scripture today, Psalm 27, 7 through 14. Let's read it. Hear, O Lord, what I cry for my voice, and be gracious to me and answer me. When you said, seek my face, my heart said to you, your face, O Lord, I shall see. Do not hide your face from me. Do not turn your servant away in anger. You have been my help. Do not abandon me or forsake me. O God, my salvation, for my father and my mother have saved me, for the Lord will take me up. Teach me your way, O Lord, and lead me in the blood path because of my foes. Do not deliver me, O Lord, to the desire of my adversaries. For false witnesses have risen against me, and such as breed my violence. I will let you spare, unless I believe that I will see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. Wait for the Lord, be strong, and let your heart take courage.
Yes, wait for the Lord.
Amen. Our gracious Heavenly Father, we are here today for one reason, and that is to worship you. And so, Lord, we pray that all of us have prepared our hearts and our minds, and we're in the right attitude, an attitude befitting of coming before the Lord to offer up sacrifices of praise to our God. And so, Lord, this is why we are here today. Lord, incline your ear, as we often read in the Psalms, and Lord, hear everything that we do and everything that we say and every song that we sing. Lord, it is from our hearts to you. Lord, these are love songs that we are singing to you. So, Lord, the songs that we sing them unto your glory, your honor, and your praise. Father, we thank you that you've given us your Son Christ. And some of us, we pray that everybody in the building, you know Jesus as your Savior. Because if eternity finds you not knowing Christ, you're going to a Christless eternity. And Jesus said that is a place of eternal outer darkness, torment, weeping, wailing, and gnashing of teeth. And so we don't want you to go there. And the difference is knowing Christ as your Savior. Salvation, it is by repentance of sin. Lord, I'm sorry for my sin.
Yes, yes.
And genuine faith in Jesus' death on the cross for your sin, his burial, and his bodily resurrection from the dead. That is salvation, and there is no other salvation besides that. Lord, open up our minds that we might, our minds and ears, that we might hear the word of God today.
Yes.
And then, Lord, let us take it to heart. Let us apply it to our lives and the world around us in order that we may live that life that is pleasing unto you. Lord, everybody needs prayer. We lift them up today. Sister Anita, Brother John, others. Lord, you know exactly what your people need, when they need it, how they need it. And so, Lord, we lift them up before you. Lord, lead us. Lord, guide us. In Jesus Christ's name we pray. Let God's people say amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Please,
standing.
Let us pray.
Amen.
Father, we have a Old Testament scripture reading, which will be Genesis 18, verses 1 through 8. Genesis 18, verses 1 through 8. And we just pray. Now the Lord appeared to him like the oaks of men while he was sitting at the tent door in the heat of the day. When he lifted up his eyes and looked, behold, three men were standing opposite him. And when he saw them, he ran from the tent door to meet them and bowed himself to the earth and said, My Lord, if now I have found favor in your sight, please do not pass your servant by. Please let a little water be brought and wash your feet and rest yourselves under the tree. And I will bring a piece of bread that you may refresh yourselves after that you may go on since you have visited your servant. And they said, so do as you have said. So Abraham hurried into the tent of Sarah and said, quickly prepare three measures of fine flour, knead it and make bread cakes. Abraham also ran to the herd and took a tender and choice calf and gave it to the servant, and he hurried to prepare it. He took curds and milk and the calf which he had prepared and placed it before them. And he was standing by them under the tree as it was. Lord, I bless you. In this word, you may be seated at this time. We will have our first congregational song this morning, Walk With Me, which is in your bulletin on page 6. I want Jesus. Thank you. scripture in Psalm 119:97. And it reads this way. Oh, how I love your law. It is my meditation all the day. Your commandments make me wiser than the kings, for they are ever mine. I have more insight than all my teachers, for your testimonies are my meditation. I understand more than the aged, because I have observed your precepts. I have restrained my feet from every evil way, that I may keep your word. I have not turned aside from your ordinances, for you yourself have taught me. How sweet are your words to my taste. Yes, sweeter than honey to my mouth. From your precepts I get understanding. Therefore, I hate every false.
Amen.
And this is so good in Matthew 13:10-17. Matthew 13:10-17. It reads as thus. And the disciples came and said to him, why do you speak to them in parables? Jesus answered them, to you it has been granted to know the mysteries of the kingdom of heaven, but to them it has not been granted. For whoever has, to him more shall be given, and he will have an abundance. But whoever does not have, even what he has, shall be taken away from him. Therefore I speak to them in parables, because while seeing, they do not see, and while hearing, they do not hear, nor do they understand. In their case, the prophecy of Isaiah is being fulfilled, which says, you will keep on hearing, but will not understand. You will keep on seeing, but will not perceive. For the heart of his people hath become dull. With their ears, they scarcely hear. And they have closed their eyes. Otherwise, they will see with their eyes, hear with their ears, and understand with their heart, and return, and I will heal them. But blessed are your eyes because they see, and your ears because they hear. For truly I say to you that many prophets and righteous men desire to see what you see and did not see it, and to hear what you hear and did not hear.
Amen.
Word, you may be seated at this time, and at this time. God.
Amen.
We're going to continue now to speak the Lord with our voices. And our last congregational song is found on page 64 of our hymnals. It says in Psalm 72, verse 19, "Praise be to His glorious name forever." Let's worship the Lord by standing.
Their own rendition and whatnot, But I think all the notes on that song were originally just played with the black keys on the piano. What they suspect is because of the flow of the song. They think the flow of the song and the melody, they really believe it came from slaves on the ship, what we call now the Middle Passage. That they had the slaves chained up in the bottom of the ship. If you've ever been on a sailing ship, there's a pattern, there's a definite rhythm when the ship is moving in the water. It sort of goes up and down, and every time it goes down, there's a splash. And so it produced a certain sway in those slaves. And they really believe a lot of these, the way these songs were put together about a slave in the field, it goes back to that, from when they were being held in chains to be brought to what they called back then, the New World. So just imagine that song being sung by slaves in the middle of a cotton field or a tobacco patch or a rice march. And they were saying, I want Jesus to walk.
Yes.
With me. And the trial was, you know, we think we got it bad. Their trial was slavery. So sometimes as we sing these songs, we need to know really what we're singing. We really have some appreciation on how far God has brought us.
Amen. Amen.
Amen. So that's one of the reasons why the older I get, I'm not really concerned about the beat,
yes,
but the words of the song.
Yeah. Yeah.
And the message it conveys and how it enables us to lift up our heart before God in praise,
yes,
and gratitude. Amen?
Yeah.
Now, when I was younger, it was all about the beat.
Yeah.
Now that just don't mean that much to me. I think because you call it mature. Amen? Your priorities. So that's just Pastor Kinlow's historical note on a song today. Amen.
Amen.
The sermon on my Mathew 1:1-12. I'm gonna start reading at verse 1, and then you all can finish by reading verse 12. Back to me. When Jesus saw the crowds, he went up on the mountain, and after he sat down, the disciples came to him. He opened his mouth and began to teach them, saying, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, who for they shall be comforted. Blessed are the gentle, for they shall inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be satisfied. Blessed are the merciful, for they shall receive mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called sons of God. Blessed are those who have been persecuted for the sake of righteousness, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when people insult you and persecute you, and falsely say all kinds of evil against you because of me. Verse 12, read.
Rejoice and be glad, for your reward in heaven is great. For in the same way they persecuted the prophets who were before you.
And God's people say amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. This is sermon number 7. Here we simply entitled the sermon on the mount. Jesus' sermon on the mount is one of 5 discourses or lectures or teaching sessions concerning serious spiritual matters. This particular discourse, Matthew 5, 6, and 7, it is the longest of 5 of these discourses that Matthew records in the gospel, so named after him. In Matthew 5, 6, and 7, it is Jesus' discourse or lecture concerning the good news of the kingdom of heaven, or the kingdom of God. And so the kingdom of heaven, or the kingdom of God, concerns God's sovereign rule over all things, all persons, all things, and this is especially true of God's sovereign rule over the hearts and minds of his people. So if you are part of the kingdom of God, God should be ruling over your heart and over your mind. He should be first and foremost in your life. Underline the word should. The circumstance was led our Lord to give us these words in Matthew 5, 6, 7. It's revealed in Matthew 4. In Matthew 4, 23 through 24, Jesus, he had been traveling throughout Syria. This was an area northeast of Galilee, the place where Jesus had been raised. Christ had been traveling through northeast Galilee, Syria. He had been teaching in the various synagogues concerning the gospel or the good news of the kingdom or the good news that God rules over all. As Jesus taught the good news of the kingdom, he also worked many supernatural signs and wonders. And they consisted of healing those who were sick from all kinds of diseases, including those who suffered from chronic pain, those who were possessed with demons, those who were suffering with epileptic seizures, and those who were suffering various forms of paralysis. Needless to say, nothing like this had ever been witnessed by any in the land of Galilee or the land of Palestine in general. And so the people, they did not understand the purpose of Jesus doing all of these fantastic signs and wonders, his reason for performing these many miracles. They were attesting signs that Jesus, he was their promised Messiah. And so the Jews' Old Testament scriptures promised them God would send them a deliverer, a Messiah, a Savior. And the Old Testament predicted he would work these signs and wonders to attest that he really was the anointed of God given to Israel, but they missed it. And so all they were paying attention to were the signs and the wonders. And so because they did not understand, they continued to bring many unto Jesus to get a sign or a wonder or a healing. And so it was because the people did not understand the purpose of Jesus' miracles that the people were merely coming for more miracles. Now, you know, when Jesus healed someone, secondarily, they did receive physical comfort.
Amen.
But that was not his primary purpose for the miracle.
That's true. Amen.
The primary purpose for the miracles was for them to turn their attention to him.
Amen.
As Messiah and Savior. And they attested that the word that he spoke, they were the very words of God. In other words, what Jesus was saying is what God was saying, literally, not virtually, but literally. His words were the very words of God. They were words coming from the very mouth of God. God manifested himself or had incarnated himself in human flesh.
Amen.
So Jesus understands these people, they're not getting it. And so when he saw these huge crowds gathered unto him for more healings, Matthew 5, 1 through 2 says, when Jesus saw the crowds, he went up on the mountain, and after he sat down, his disciples came to him. He opened his mouth, and he began to teach them, saying, now, you know, I never am able to give you everything that I glean from these texts and my research and study of these texts. And I actually have another whole sermon, and I don't know when I'll get to it, and it simply comes from the words, and after he sat down, the disciples came, he opened his mouth and began to teach him. In the Hebrew culture, it really gives us great insight into Jesus' teaching or preaching style. He sat down. That was the normal posture the rabbi would take when he began to teach his students. So he would sit down, and all the students would gather around him, and he would begin to instruct the didaskos,
teach them for the purpose of opening up their minds to understand. And what I wanted to say, but I'm not going to say it today, is this. Jesus' preaching style, his teaching style, according to what we think is anointed preaching today, we would have said Jesus was really not anointed in his preaching and teaching.
Yeah.
He never taught to arouse the crowd.
Right.
Mm-hmm. He never taught to get people shook up and stirred up. He never taught a preacher, I don't know, get his hanky out and throw it at the crowd, or you know, however we do it today. Or some used to do it. This was his normal teaching method. He wasn't emotional. He didn't run all over the place. I don't know how far you want me to take this, because I really might be offending someone. He did not go,
amen.
What I'm trying to tell you is, what we think is anointed, it's not anointed at all.
Yeah.
Now, if there was anybody who was anointed as God, it was Jesus.
Yeah.
And if there was any pattern we ought to be trying to follow, it is Jesus. He was truly the anointed one of God. And so he sat down to teach these folks because they do not understand. But today, that's not anointed. Somebody told me one time, you don't really preach, you just teach. And they said it to denigrate me. But they did not understand, you know, that's all Jesus did. But let me move on today.
Come on, tell the truth.
Jesus clearly understood these crowds needed to be taught, as evidenced through the fact that he sits down to teach them. The word teach, it's didasco, it means he's teaching in order to open up their mind that they might understand the kingdom of God. He wants them to understand that the kingdom of the Messiah is in their very midst. And so in view of all of that, I want to continue this journey and finish the blessed bees this Sermon on the Mount, because next Sunday I'm going to move into another characteristic of those who are part of the kingdom. And that is, they are the salt of the earth. So I could have went into Matthew 5:13, but I don't want to combine two subjects in one sermon. I want you to think about just one thing. So I want to take a deeper look at verse 12. And Jesus simply said, rejoice and be glad, for your reward in heaven is great. For in the same way they persecuted the prophets who were before you. In order to fully comprehend what Jesus says in verse 12, you have to comprehend what he first said in 10 through 11. In verse 10, Jesus said, it is evidence that one possesses the favor of God, or they are blessed of God. Remember the word blessed be, or however you want to put it, it's the Greek word makarios. It means the one who possesses the favor of God. You are blessed of God. You possess the favor of God. You are blessed of God. So he is saying that it is evidence that one possesses the favor of God, or they are blessed by God, if they are persecuted for the sake of not compromising on those things that conform to the holy nature and character of God. You are blessed if you have been persecuted for standing upon that which is right in the mind of God. You know, if you've been persecuted by others or pursued after or talked about badly because you don't compromise the biblical truth that in the mind of God, marriage is an act between a male and a female. Genesis 2:22-24, the Lord God fashioned into a woman the rib, which he had taken from the man and brought her to the man. The man said, this is now bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh. She shall be called woman. That's the Hebrew word isha, because she was taken out of the man. That's the word ish. Man is ish. Woman is isha. Ish means man. Isha means taken out of the man. I probably need to stay here. Because what I'm saying today is a lot of people think that has been reversed.
Well, teach us. Yeah.
Now, God didn't make you first, sister and he didn't. Yeah. He didn't make us out of your rib.
Well,
You come from us. Let me move on to that. So God has an order here. And you know, we see the rebellion of the women in the church today more than ever. You know, you want to prove your womanhood by doing what I do. You're trying to prove how much of a woman you are by acting as much as a man as you can. Something wrong about all this. That's not my sermon. Let me move on. It's really right. Took the woman out of the man's side and fashioned her. And then God brings her to the man. And God says, for this cause, a man shall leave his father and mother. It's your own crib. Amen. And be joined to his wife. And they shall be one flesh. When you stand upon that without favor and you are persecuted, Jesus says, you are blessed of God. You possess the favor of God. You are exhibiting one of the principles that you really are part of the kingdom of God. In verse 11, the Lord goes on to say, it is evidence that one possesses the favor of God if people insult you, persecute you, and speak falsely of you. The Lord says, because of me. That's a specific persecution, because you've taken a stand on Jesus that he's number one. Everybody and everything else is number two. He's way up here. Everybody else is way down here. He's at the throne of your life, and people are persecuting you because of that. He says, you are blessed of God. Then he says in verse 12, rejoice and be glad. For what? Persecution. People are railing at you with abusive words. People saying lies about you because you stand for that which is righteous. Jesus is number one. The Lord says, rejoice and be glad. For your reward in heaven is great. Why? For in the same way they persecuted the prophets who were before you. If you have been persecuted or pursued by others to do you harm, either in body or reputation, for the sake of righteousness, rejoice and be glad. If some have railed against you with abusive words and spread ugly lies against you because you're uncompromising in regards to Jesus, his redemptive work on the cross, his person, everything attached to him, you will not compromise. The Lord says, rejoice and be glad, because your reward in heaven is great.
Amen.
The reason why this is true is because you are in the same class as the Old Testament prophets. From the same way they were persecuted, they were harmed physically, in body and reputation, they were railed against with abusive words, they were spoken of falsely, in other words, people told big old lies against these men. When the Lord says rejoice, it's a Greek word, kairo. It means to be glad, be bright, be cheerful, smile. When folks are mad at you because you won't compromise, Jesus, one eye open. Amen?
Amen.
And then he says rejoice and be glad. It's a Greek word, agaleo, and it means to leap for joy. So if folks insult you, speak against you with disparaging words, persecute you, seek to do you harm bodily or physically, speak all kinds of lies against you because you refuse to compromise one thing in regards to that which is righteous, in regard to the person and work of Jesus Christ, the Lord Jesus Christ, Son of God, Son of Man, God of very God, eternally begotten, not made, woman the Father in all things, says, then rejoice, smile, and be glad, then leap for joy. Because great is your reward.
Yes.
In heaven. For in the same way they persecuted the prophets who were before you. Now when Jesus says great is your reward in heaven, he is speaking of the eternity to come. And that will ultimately culminate with God ushering in a new heaven and a new earth. The Bible says God will dwell among men and God will be all in all. In view of this, the rewards from God to those who are blessed and possess the favor of God as evidence. They are insulted, they are persecuted, they are spoken of falsely for the sake of righteousness and for following Jesus with no compromise. The reward is eternal, or the reward will never end.
Amen.
The reward will never end. It will never cease. You know, there are rewards for compromising righteousness, but they are temporary.
Amen.
There are earthly rewards for, you know, putting Jesus on the back burner.
Well,
they are from the world and they are temporary. I guarantee you, if I, Dr. Lloyd, E. Kinlow II, B.A., M.D., D.D., and all that other stuff, and it really don't mean nothing, I still like scrolling crazy. Amen. I love all the titles, B.A., and Masters, I've earned all that stuff, I still love me some squirrel and gravy. Amen. Rice. Side of green. Right. It's a good old hunk of cornbread. Amen. So don't get carried away with that because I'm not. Amen. My wife frowned at me. If I call up the repository and say, you know, God told me I've been wrong in the past years for preaching and teaching marriages between a man and a woman. If I call him up and say, you know, I've made a mistake, God got it wrong back in Genesis, but now he's corrected himself. God is down with same-sex marriage now. And I fly the rainbow flag in front of the church.
No.
I guarantee you I'll get some accolades from the world of unredeemed men. The membership of this church probably will grow as those who are living out the sin of homosexuality, lesbianism, transgenderism, binary genderism in their lives. I'm going to that church. Now, let me say something. If you're going to a church because it condones your sin, you are in the wrong place. That's a church you don't need to go to. I'm going to that church. Everybody in there in adultery. That's where I'm going. That's where I belong. God has called me there. I'm in adultery. The preacher in adultery. The deacon's in adultery. The elders in adultery. The choir director in adultery. Everybody in adultery. I'm in adultery. I'm going there so I can praise the Lord. If you are going to a church because they are condoning your sin, you are attending no church at all. We may get some monetary donations. I'll probably get an article at the minimum in the repository. Preacher finally sees the light. The flying the ointment is, these are temporary.
Yes. Yes.
At most, when I die, they cease. And then I'll have to give an account to God for condoning what he says throughout scripture he loathes and is abominable in his sight. Mm-hmm. See, there is earthly reward for compromising the things of God and compromising righteousness, but they are temporary. They cease when you leave this world.
Amen.
And then you'll have to give an account to God. In contrast, the rewards for taking an uncompromising stand on the things God has declared righteous, the rewards for being uncompromising concerning the person and work of Jesus, they will never end. But they will be experienced with great joy forever in heaven. Now, I don't think in our limited minds we really understand what it means to experience reward and joy and gladness forever. I don't think it's possible for us to really understand that right now, because everything that brings us joy in this world eventually becomes ho-hum. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Everything. I wish I had that. You get it? After a while. When I first got my truck out there, I said, "Dad, car wash, give me the works. Wash that undercarriage out and put that coating on, and you know, and now it's, oh well, amen." Now I'm taking care of the engine and all that, but it ain't. There was some joy there, but it just didn't last. And I told my daughter, rejoice and be glad you got your new car. Wait till the payment book to come in, amen. See, every joy we experience, it is temporary. We don't know what it's like to have everlasting joy yet. We don't know what it's like to be rewarded by God and forever be glad and cheerful and happy and shouting and praising God, and it never ends. We don't understand that right now, but one day we will. And the way to experience that is for you, Christian, is to never compromise when you are persecuted for the sake of righteousness. Never compromise this God man that we worship that saved us. His name is Jesus Christ. For great is your reward in heaven, and that reward is forever and forever and forever. And right now I don't understand that, but one day I will, because the Bible says, in that day I will know as I have known right now. But the opposite is also true. I don't think we understand what it means when the Bible says some Christians are going to suffer eternal loss. How can I say it? Because you're a lousy Christian.
Amen.
Corinthians 3. You will be saved. But the Bible says we're lost. Just like a man, the Bible said, just like a man barely escaping out of a burning house. In other words, everything you got burned up.
Yeah.
But you made it. Hair singed, eyebrows singed, clothes halfway burned off your back. But you made it. That's the picture God gives to some Christians in heaven. Why? Because they never did nothing for the Lord on earth. So we don't comprehend eternal reward, but we also don't comprehend eternal loss, because, you know, while we're here, we can make it. All right. But up there, that won't be. But the kids, if you want eternal reward, stand on Jesus. You know, be uncompromised by as much Bible as you know. If all you know Jesus well, don't compromise. That's the shortest verse in the Bible. Somebody said, Jesus never cried. Stand on it. Yes, it did. He said, Jesus wept. That's the only verse you know. Stand on it. Amen. Be uncompromised about Jesus. The great is your reward in heaven. But they persecuted the prophets who came before you in the exact same way. Stand on all the truth you know without compromise.
Amen.
The reward is in that. Lord says, rejoice and be glad, for your reward in heaven is great, for in the same way they persecuted the prophets who were before you. According to Jesus, all of the Old Testament prophets were persecuted. They were done harm either in reputation or body. All of them were railed at with abusive words. That means they got cursed out. Well, cussed out, depending on what neighborhood you're from. Amen. All of them were spoken of falsely. Yet they were those of it who were blessed by God. They possessed the favor of God, and their reward in heaven is great. That's one of the most profound statements in the Bible. It requires much deep thought. An application by the church today. I say this because Jesus' words concerning the prophets infers or indicates this was the experience of every Old Testament prophet, none exempted. Jesus did not say they persecuted some or a few of the prophets before you in this way. No, he said the prophets. So that's a general statement. In general, the Old Testament prophets were persecuted in body and in reputation. They were railed out with abusive words. They were cursed out by the people. They were spoken of with false words, big old lies. In Jeremiah 28, Hananiah brought Jeremiah before all the people and the priests and accused him of being a big old liar. Then he broke that wooden yoke God told Jeremiah to put around his neck. The Bible says he broke it off his neck. Now, you know that had to hurt. By the time we get to Jeremiah 32, they've thrown him in prison. Why? Standing on true the righteousness of God. Let me explore this in brief. The Old Testament prophets consisted of both major and minor prophets. The distinction between the major and minor prophet does not mean the major prophets had more authority than the minor prophets, or the major prophets were spiritually superior over the minor prophets, or that the major prophets had what they had to say was truer than what the minor prophets had to say. The distinction is the major prophet, they just wrote more, while the minor prophets wrote less. Isaiah wrote more than any of the Old Testament prophets, 66 chapters in his book. Obadiah just wrote one chapter. Yet both Isaiah and Obadiah's words bear the exact and same equal authority of God. For what they wrote was just as breathed out. Obadiah's one chapter was just as breathed out by God as Isaiah's 66. Both the major and minor prophets' writings bore and continue to bear today the full authority of God. For what both major and minor prophets declared in their writings is what God has said, and in some way it is applicable to us today. Believe it or not, there's an important principle in that we need to understand in the church, and it is this. We who are churchified, that's not an addition to anything. But we who are churchified tend to assume a greater authority in the preaching of men according to their ministry size. I got 2 minutes. The man who pastored the megachurch is perceived by many to be the one who is really being used by God in the greatest sense. And the smaller ministry is the lesser. It is perceived to be used by God, being used by God maybe, but in a lesser way. It is probably accurate to say many, and maybe even most today, believe that the larger the ministry, the more truth in the pulpit. Now, I consider Dr. John MacArthur to be one of the greatest preachers of our day. I personally learned from his preaching and his books probably more than any other resource except the scripture themselves. Dr. MacArthur, and rightly so, he is internationally known, and for good reason. That is his faithfulness in the pulpit. And he's willing to deal with controversial subjects that have caused him a whole lot of negative feedback. I consider myself to be absolutely of no significance in the church today. Most have no idea who I am. They don't care to know who I am. You know I am, think very little of me. Yeah. For various reasons. And most of them because I'm preaching something they just don't like. Even though it's clearly seen in the scripture.
Amen.
You know, when I'm out on the streets and people who know me know I've been pastoring over 30 years. You know, ain't no rumors out on me, chasing sisters and all this, that.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
And know I've been doing this 30 plus years. Earned masters in this stuff, earned doctorate in this stuff. And I understand what they're doing when they just say, David. They wanted me to address me by my title. At least one of them. Please call me Mr. Kinlow, amen. They don't call me Mr. Kinlow, they don't call me Pastor Kinlow, they don't call me Reverend Kinlow, they don't call me Elder Kinlow. Even though I've earned it, they don't call me Dr. Kinlow, they just say David. I understand it's disrespect. I get it.
Well,
And normally I say nothing. The older I get, I've made up my mind. The next time somebody does it, I'm just going to ask them as nice as I can. Because I want to know. I've been doing this a long time. And I'm just dated to you. Now, if you want to call me that, fine, but just tell me why. But the point is, Dr. Crawford, a huge preacher, tremendous preacher. I love his preaching. I can't wait to get back to California to the Shepherd's Conference. Back this time. Now, Dr. Crawford, I can make the exact same observation about a text of scripture. Most will give my thoughts, will give very little of my observation. But they'll listen closely to Dr. McCarthy because they think his words are of a greater weight and authority. The reason why this is true is we tend to assign greater authority and significance according to physical size and ministry. The truth is just that the major prophets wrote more than the minor prophets, yet their words equally bore and bear the full authority of God. There are men who are faithful in the pulpit, in the large church, the medium church, the small church, the storefront, and crying out loud on the street corner. But they're all preaching the same word of God, and that word of God bears equal authority. I don't care who it's coming from.
Yes.
The authority is not in the instrument. It is not in the man. It is in the authority of God. That is, he is infused in the scriptures, the word of God.
Amen.
Amen.
In addition to the major and minor prophets, there's another class of prophets in the Bible. They were called the non-writing prophets. In other words, they never wrote a book that is included in the Old Testament canon, but small portions of their ministries and what they taught. They were written up specifically by the historians in the Bible, 1 and 2 Samuel, 1 and 2 Kings, and 1 and 2 Chronicles. The major prophets were Isaiah, Jeremiah, Ezekiel, and Daniel. The minor prophets were Hosea, Joel, Amos, Obadiah, Jonah, Micah, Nahum, Habakkuk, Zephaniah, Haggai, Zechariah, and Malachi. The non-writing prophets were Elijah with the J, Elijah with the S, Micaiah, Nathan, Samuel, Ahijah, Azariah. There's one unnamed prophet in the Bible in 1 Kings 13:1. He is simply identified as a man of God. And then, of course, there's Moses. He's unique. He stands all by himself because he wrote the first five books of the Bible that all the other prophets based their ministry and their preaching and their prophecy upon.
Amen.
Preach.
Teach.
According to Jesus, all of these guys were murdered.
Amen.
Matthew 23:29-30, or greatly persecuted. Matthew 23:29-31, listen to what the Lord says. Woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, for you build the tombs of the prophets and adorn the monuments of the righteous and say, we have been living in the days of our fathers, we would not have been partners with them in the shedding of blood of the prophets. So the Lord says, so you testify yourself that you are the son of those who murdered the prophets. They were all murdered, or greatly persecuted, or many of them were murdered. Let me put it that way. Stephen, one of the first deacons in the church, was stoned to death by the religious leaders in Jerusalem because he confronted them with the truth that their forefathers had murdered the Old Testament prophets. Acts 7:52, Stephen says, which one of the prophets did not your fathers persecute? They killed those who had previously announced the coming of the righteous one, whose betrayers and murderers you have become. Hebrews 11:36-38. It describes how the prophets lived and what they endured in their ministry. Let me read it to you. And others experienced mockings and scourging, yes, also chains and imprisonment. They were stoned, they were sawn in two, they were tempted, they were put to death with a sword, they went about in sheepskins and goatskins, being destitute, afflicted, ill-treated, men of whom the world was not worthy, wandered in deserts and mountains and caves and holes in the ground. Now that was the Old Testament prophet. I don't know nobody going to seminary for that.
Amen.
I don't know any aspiring ministers ready for that. Several observations I want to make and then I'm out of here. Number one, these were the true prophets of God. They taught the people the knowledge of God. They reminded the people of their duties to God. When the people lapsed into sin,
They reproved the people of their sin by calling out directly what the sin was, in order that the people could repent and reform themselves back to God. If the people did not repent and reform themselves, then what did they do? They prophesied of their coming judgment from the hand of God. Unlike today, the vast majority of the Old Testament prophets prophesying consisted of foretelling or predicting judgment. Did you hear what I just said? Most of their prophecy was, if y'all don't get right, God's gonna kill all of y'all. That was most of their prediction.
Amen.
Get right with God or perish.
Amen.
That was their prophecy. They would say, thus saith the Lord, this, repent, turn. If you don't, judgment of God is coming. That was a prediction. You're on the way to getting smacked by God.
Amen.
And their prophecy was always based upon what Moses had already written in the law of God. So their prophecy was predicated upon what? The scriptures rightly divided.
Amen.
Let me give you, let me quickly, Deuteronomy 30, 15 through 18, let me read it. God says, see, I set before you today life and prosperity and death and adversity. And that I command you today to love the Lord your God, to walk in his ways and to keep his commandments and his statutes and his judgments, that you may live and multiply, and that the Lord your God may bless you in the land where you are entering to possess. But if your heart turns away and you will not obey, but are drawn away and worship other gods and serve them, I declare to you today that you shall surely perish. The Old Testament prophet would always preach based upon texts such as those. They would say, Israel, you're in idolatry, you're worshiping Asherah, you're worshiping Baal, you got a bunch of homosexuals sitting up, set up camp in the temple, in the courtyard, amen? Every man up there under a green tree, you're always on a high hill, offering up raisin cakes to some false god, you're worshiping dead god, you're worshiping Baal. They were taken back to what Deuteronomy said, when God said, when you start doing this and are drawn after other gods, they would tell them, God has already said you shall surely perish, and they would say, judgment is on the way. They also prophesied of the coming Messiah, the final judgment of God, and the eternity to come. The bulk of their prophecy was in relationship to these things, judgment, the Messiah, the final judgment of God, the eternity to come. But you never see any of the prophets in the Bible functioning like these so-called prophets today, who look into the TV and say, God is telling me there's someone out there in television land, you're suffering from a severe headache, you're suffering from a severe backache, I want you to lay your hands on the television screen right now, and then send in a love gift of $59.95, and your breakthrough is about to come, your healing, it is on the way. You never saw any of the Old Testament prophets stand in somebody's congregation and say, you know what, you're going to get a new car, you're going to get a new Lexus, you're going to get a new chariot with gold and white. The rain is that, you know, God is telling me that your phone number is 455-89-55-55-55, and that's how you know I'm a prophet. It already has somebody looked up before you got in there. You never heard a prophet prophesy how great they were and how much God was going to bless them and give them this tremendous religious empire. And I just see myself preaching in a giant auditorium with a sloped floor and more people than I. You don't find one prophet prophesying that kind of junk.
Amen.
The reason why the prophets today are nothing like the ones in the Bible is they are no prophets at all.
Amen.
They are false prophets and false prophetesses. And they are deceiving and being deceived, as Paul says in 2 Timothy.
Yeah. Teach us.
But evil men and seducers will proceed from bad, the worst, deceiving and being deceived.
Yeah.
Or they're just scripturally ignorant.
Amen.
That's it.
Amen.
Number two, there are about 25 prophets in the Old Testament, including the major, the minor prophets, the non-writing prophets, Moses, and the one unnamed prophet in 1 Kings 13:1, just 25. And they prophesied over a period of 1,400 years. When you look at that mathematically, here's what you get. Since there were approximately 25, because I know some of y'all don't go home and research and say there's 10. six-pack. Don't call me, man. That's why I said approximately. The number is close. There were approximately 25 prophets who prophesied over 1,400 years here. What that means is there was only a genuine prophet of the Lord every 56 years.
Wow.
But only one genuine prophet spoke every 672 months. From this, we know there were not thousands of prophets running all over the land getting words.
Amen.
They were very few.
Very few.
Wow.
In contrast, what we see today is thousands of so-called prophetesses, prophets and prophetesses running all over the place, getting words from the Lord 24/7. I know churches got 8, 9, 10. In the pew every Sunday. Everybody getting the word from the Lord. Everybody got a revelation. God told me. Everybody getting, and I'm saying, wait a minute now, in the Bible, these every so once in a while, God would raise up a man.
Amen.
Let me say that. He would raise up a man who would cry aloud and stare not. You didn't have everybody in synagogue standing up, Lord, just told me they would have stoned you, amen. What I'm saying is the reason why you see a difference today is these prophets and prophetesses, they are no prophets and prophetesses of God at all. They are phonies. Number three, there's a vast discrepancy between the prophets and scriptures retreated by the world and how they live their general lives, as opposed to these today who are living in large,
right,
in a big way. These prophets and prophetesses today, woo-wee, they possess mansions, much gold, more gold, much diamonds, much Rolexes, a fleet of luxury automobiles, private jets, private helicopters, designer everything, and an entourage that follows them from city to city. I heard one say they never wear the same suit of clothing twice. I heard one say, don't y'all buy me nothing. You can't afford the clothes that I wear. They're adored by the world. They attend the Emmys, the Oscars, the BET Awards, the American Music Awards, the Golden Globe Awards. They're sitting out there in the audience and dancing with the stars. And the world loves them in contrast. This is what the Bible says about the true prophets of God. Hebrews 11, 36, 38. And others experienced mocking, scourging, yes, also chains and imprisonment. They were stoned. They were sawn in two. They were tempted. They were put to death with the sword. They went about in sheepskins and goatskins, being destitute, afflicted, ill-treated men whom the world was not worthy, wandering in the deserts and mountains and caves and holes in the ground. We see no evidence in this clan of prophets today where they're ill-treated in any way for the sake of the gospel. But we do see them claim they're being attacked by the devil when someone has the audacity to stand up to them and said, the scriptures do not say that. The reason why these prophets are different than those in the Bible is there be no prophets at all. Here's what they really are. They are religious hustlers.
Amen.
Religious prostitutes.
Amen.
And pulpit. Somebody said, what?
Tell the truth.
Y'all got a problem with that, don't y'all? We need to take you to Amos.
Amen.
Amos was prophesied. And a man in front of him said, I dare you speak just like that. And Amos said, I tell you what. In a few weeks, your wife gonna be prostituting in the streets. But he didn't use the word prostitute. He used another word that we can't take today because I don't know why, but it's in the Bible. So they're religious prostitutes and pulpit pimps.
Amen.
Who often shelter themselves when confronted by the word of God by quoting 1 Chronicles 16:20, touch not mine anointed ones, and do my prophet no harm. But since you're not anointed, and since you are not a prophet, let me do you some harm. That is not what the Bible says. Truth of the matter is plain and stated by our Lord Jesus Christ. In Matthew 5:12, rejoice and be glad, for the reward in heaven is great. For in the same way they persecuted the prophets who were before you. The Old Testament prophets were greatly favored by God. They were blessed because they were persecuted, railed at with abusive words and falsely spoken of by many. Yet they endured by standing on the truth of God's word without compromise. As a result, the reward in heaven is great. It endures forever and ever and ever. Likewise, those who are blessed by God, those who possess the favor of God, those who are really part of the kingdom of God through Jesus Christ, they will be often persecuted for the sake of righteousness. They will be persecuted for staying consistent and standing on those things that are consistent with the holy nature and character of God. They are often spoken of by others with abusive words. I can't stand that yellow man down here on Richmond Avenue. Falsely spoken of when it comes to taking an uncompromised stand for Jesus, the Messiah, Son of God, Savior from sin, the one who died on the cross for sin, buried in body, rose from the dead, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. I know none of us have been persecuted to the point that we have had to shed blood, but if you have experienced persecution for the sake of righteousness, railed at through abusive words and spoken of falsely because you've made Jesus number one in your life. Rejoice. Be glad. Be cheerful. Smile. Leap for joy. For according to Jesus, your reward in heaven is great, and it will endure forever and ever and ever. And you are living in the footsteps of all the prophets who were for you. Never compromise the word of God. And never sell Jesus down the drain. The reward in heaven is great. Amen. I'm going to stop and I'll pick up next Sunday in verse 13. When I begin to talk about you are part of the kingdom, you are supposed to be the salt of the earth. That's perfect. Amen. 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 Gracious Heavenly Father, you're all for this come. Lord, Lord God, please open up our minds. We may get an understanding of your word. And then, Lord, melt and crush our hearts that we will subject ourselves to what you have spoken to us through your word. Even though there are some things in the Bible we're not going to like, most often it's because they shine a spotlight on those raggedy and sinful areas of our life. But even when that's the case, submit yourself to God according to his word. Learn it, never compromise it. No matter what kind of persecution comes your way. And Jesus says to you, great is your reward in heaven. Amen.
Amen.
Salvation is by grace through faith in Jesus Christ. Wherever eternity finds you, it's going to keep you there. If you don't know Jesus Christ as your Savior, Jesus said you will be cast into outer darkness, where there's weeping and wailing and gnashing of teeth before the serpent. Sister Perry was talking to me about a gentleman, good shape, exercise, ate right, retired as a high-ranking officer out of an organization. I I may be getting the story wrong. Exercise a little bit, 20 minutes. Sat down and died. None of us know when that day is going to come. But it's going to come. And I know it's not talked about much. It's heaven and it's eternal separation from God in hell and torment. Jesus said that because you have rejected him. Out of all that you do in life, somewhere along the way, you need to have an honest conversation with God and say, God, I know I messed up. I know I'm a sinful man or woman. I got a raggedy life. I got a lot of skeletons in the closet. Some of these things I'm greatly ashamed of, and I don't want anybody to know. Lord, I know I'm a sinner, but Lord, have mercy on me. Lord, I'm sorry for my sin. I repent. Jesus, I want you to come into my life. You died for me on Calvary's cross for my sins. You were buried and you rose from the dead on the third day. You ascended back to heaven. You sat down at the right hand of the Father. And Jesus, I want you to receive me when I leave this world. That can happen at any time. Salvation is through Jesus Christ alone. You need to ask yourself, do you know him? Do you know him? If you don't, you are just lost and destined to that place Jesus described as an awful place, torment forever. There is one today and you want to give your life to Jesus Christ. The altar workers up here, we have always have a man to deal with any male and a female to deal with any female. There's one today, and God is speaking to your heart, and you feel so moved to let one of these altar workers pray and minister to you. If there is one, just raise your hand today. Savior, Jesus Christ. So Father, we thank you today. Is there another? We believe you want God to be, you to be part of this church, and you want to be a member here, and really pray about it. We want you to take some time to do this. You know, take your time, read through the doctrine, attend. Because we want you to be certain. We want you to be where God wants you to be. If there is one today, as you raise your hand, these altar workers can help you with that. If there's one, you raise your hand. Father God, I thank you and praise you for all things today. Lord, I pray for those who need that special prayer. Praying for Brother John. Lord, we believe he's going to be all right. Lord, get him back snuff. Bring him back. Amen.
Amen.
Pray for Sister Juanita. Continued treatments with cancer. Lord, we pray that you would just continue to infuse healing in their body. We pray for others who are in grief still. It doesn't go away. My mother-in-law lost her husband. Others in grief lost loved ones. And so, Lord, we pray that you will be the God of all comfort. Lord, lead us. Lord, guide us. In Jesus Christ's name we pray. That God's people say amen.
Amen. Amen.